Thank you very much. So now something completely different, containers and Kubernetes. So we are doing this really for 3 years now, and it was a nice and sometimes adventurous journey. So we are a Berlin-based company, that's me, focus mainly on system automation, DevOps, and personally I focus on cloud database and be a software architect for clouds. And we are doing Kubernetes since September 2015, because we had a customer who wanted to escape the OpenStack environment of the mother company, and they asked for Kubernetes. So we are doing this. Our company, so we do open source projects mostly. We commit everything as, if possible, if the customer allows it to back upstream. So if you do a change or make Ansible playbooks for Kubernetes, then we push them upstream. We have some decades of experience in our team. I collected it. I think we have 100,000 server years of experience in public and private cloud somewhere. And we are going with open source, and this is where we start. So this is the content of the talk. I will give you an overview about the basic containers. Containers is not equal to Docker, so there are differences. There was a talk this morning, and somebody asked, where is Docker 18 in Kubernetes? And the answer is, it will never be, because they changed the default container engine for some reason. And that's why Kubernetes and Docker are different topics. Kubernetes itself has nice concepts like pods, networks, services. I will give a short overview, and then I will go into the practical things, case studies, one telephony company, one big customer who produces ERP systems, who does a lot of things on premises. The most challenging thing was machine learning in Kubernetes. This is easy now with Kubeflow, but I try to explain what makes this interesting and special. So this is more or less, we are Google partners, so disclaimer, how Google sees it. So here is some infrastructure, not necessarily Google, you also could say it's Amazon or your own infrastructure. Then you have virtual machines, and top of that you have containers, of something in the Google Cloud like an app engine, which is a simplified container. And the nirvana of computing is the serverless or the functions stuff. We don't have any server, but the functions all need these layers below, and it's not really possible to run something without having some infrastructure somewhere. As Martin Alfke yesterday explained, so this is an idealization which simply drops all the knowledge about the underlying tiers. So if you talk about Kubernetes, if you talk about containers, it depends what people are understanding about containers. So the developers normally think it's just a kind of lightweight virtual machine. This is true and not true, because if you talk to Linux guys, it's just a process in a namespace with capabilities protected by seccomp with an overlay file system, and that's it. So both parts have their own opinion about it, and both people are right. So it depends on how you see it. But if they talk to each other, if you have a DevOps and a lot of wine and meal, and then you can trigger an interesting discussion on that. So containers or virtualization, normally I start with this comparison. So what is the isolation level? Isolation level is completely different. Normally in virtualization, you have the Intel CPU ring 0, ring 3 thing, and this guarantees an isolation on the CPU level, or should guarantee it. Container completely relies on the operating system. In our case, mostly Linux, but also BSD has some container concepts, so it's not limited to Linux, but mostly it's Linux. You cannot emulate phone CPUs in containers, but with virtualization you can. Every Android developer does it. You cannot have a foreign kernel. You have exactly that kernel of the operating system, so the kernel is common. You don't need to emulate devices. In virtualization, you need to emulate devices. This is a security issue. You can use host devices directly in a container. So you can use a tunnel device in a container and create new tunnels. In a virtualization environment, you need something like VIRT.io driver, and this limits the performance a little bit because the payoff for network performance is CPU cycles. So you exchange CPU cycles and network performance here. CPU performance normally is 100% in containers. There is no difference because it's a process directly on the operating system. The I/O performance of the CPU performance of virtualization is because of some overhead, normally 95%, so it's not bad in any way. The I/O performance in a virtual environment can break down if you are beyond the threshold of something between 1 and 10 gigabit per second. So then you need other techniques to attach the underlying devices, which are under development at the moment. Another thing is root isolation. It's guaranteed with virtualization. In container, you can have it, and you can enforce it. But be aware, most of the examples on Docker Hub and the internet are wrong here. They use root in a container, which is absolutely not necessary. You don't need to run an Nginx as root in a container, because to transport the socket, the TCP/IP socket, to the outside world, you have to change the port anyway several times. So there is no need to use port 80. It's nonsense. But these are 99% of the examples on the internet. And if you forbid running root processes in a Docker or Kubernetes environment like OpenShift does, the basic examples don't work anymore. You cannot simply use it. You have to adapt them. And this is a little bit uncomfortable. One thing is, I looked it up in 4 years ago in a 31st Chaos Computer Congress, there was a talk about hypervisors, and that in hypervisors, CPU cache attacks are possible. So MMUs are susceptible to CPU cache attacks. And this means if you can even pass a MMU barrier, it's much easier in a container. And this is, I have this sheet since the very beginning, since 3 years more or less. And I asked for a proof of concept. Now Meltdown and Spectre have delivered more or less. So this is something you have to be aware of. If you run very, very secret things in a container or in an MMU, please use dedicated hardware. There is no way around it. And at the moment, we cannot trust the CPU to a level that you can say, I can prevent an attach on a private key completely. So if you have this security demand, dedicate hardware for it. By the way, we are Google partners. Without making too much advertising in the Google Cloud, you can have dedicated hardware in the near future. So you can say, I want to have my private machines. And then you get this demand. Then you have a lot of, then you have a real big machine, and then maybe you waste a lot of memory and money, but you are secure. So this is the same thing as a picture. With virtual machines, normally you have this hypervisor. Normally it's QEMU KVM. The KVM part is okay. The KVM part is okay, but as Google told us, QEMU is a pile of crap. So they removed QEMU from the hypervisor in the Google Cloud, so they are running their own KVM without all the security bugs, and this is absolutely what we should be aware of. QEMU normally has too much things inside it, like floppy disk drivers. Who knows floppy disks? So this is the elder generation here. Floppy disk for the younger. This is a symbol for if you save a Word document. This is a symbol. And the drivers are unmaintained and therefore crappy, and you don't need it. And this applies also to CD-ROMs, DVD-ROMs, and anything which is outdated. So this means in this thing you have something which is heavily insecure here, and run it and say, oh, virtualization is more safe than containers. No, it's not. And in a container environment, the processes have namespaces. I will explain a little bit later what namespaces are. But you run it normally directly on the underlying kernel. One side remark, because one of our customers forced us to do it, you can run a QAMO KVM in a container. And nobody can stop you from doing this. And actually, the feedback was, Windows in a container, in a KVM process, which is very simplified, is easier to maintain than Windows by Windows means. This is strange, but this works. So, and you can really change it. There's one new hypervisor-like thing which really works. I tested it. It's a gVisor from Google. It's a Linux in user space, so you use a Go application, which can be controlled. You run it instead of an hypervisor and can use it as a container runtime. So, and they prevent all these kernel calls, which they consider as insecure. Another option is from Intel, Intel Clear Containers. There are Ubuntu packages for this. This works also, and obviously you can use KVM in containers. And on non-Linux OS, you have X-Hive or Hyper-V, which I started before. So actually, you can mix it if you want it. You will lose some performance, but the trade-off may be okay if you gain some security for this. This is up to your analysis of the security thing, and this could help. What are these namespace things? So there's a list of namespaces. And most, even experienced Linux administrators, are not aware what these namespaces are. So let's go through it. You have these namespaces, something like C group, which is more or less a performance, so CPU cycles and memory restriction of your process. You can put a C group around the process, and then the C group defines the memory and how much CPU cycles the process gets. There is an issue here with Java, which ignores this completely, but the latest versions of Java should really do it right now, that you can say, okay, I want to put a C group around this process so you don't get all the memory, you get a part of it. And then you have good old System 5 inter-process communication, IPC. And this is a namespace of its own. There are POSIX, message queues. You can use semaphores, locks directly in memory. This is something which is really necessary if you want to communicate fast inside a system. Network is an entire namespace. This means, if you create a network namespace, you also can do it with Docker alone, then you get a completely different set of network. You get different IP tables rules, for example. IP tables rules are namespace aware, so you can have a tunnel inside a container which has completely different routing and IP tables and can circumvent every security outside things, or can establish a new level of security here. You should be aware of it. This means every process which is in the same namespace has the same local host. So 127 something addresses are the same. If one opens a port, you can access it from another process in the same network namespace. Mount points, the same with mount points. You can share devices and parts of the file system between different containers. So this is this part of it. Process ID, you might have noticed in a container, everything starts with a process ID number one, which is the PID namespace. So a process then has a has a process ID outside this namespace, and inside the namespace, if you do a top, everything starts with one. This is one of the features. User namespace is the same. You can have a root user inside a container, and if you apply the user namespace correctly, then it is not the user zero outside a container. So if something goes wrong with the kernel call, you can hope that the kernel is able to establish the security rules because it's a non-root user. But there is no need to use root inside a container, but this is another level of protection. And last but not least, hostname and NIS domain, so this resolve.conf more or less, is also a namespace of its own. So you can have a completely different DNS inside a container. This is important to know. This is not related to Docker. Docker simply is using this and makes it very simple to create these namespaces. This is a Linux-only feature. Okay, maybe it was on Solaris zones a little bit, but this definitely works. So this is a container in my definition. It's an isolated process with a different set of namespaces, period. By the way, you can ask questions anytime if I'm too fast or not clear enough. So that's the definition here. And now, for example, we can go deeper into the control group part. You can have CPU, memory, you can have a set of CPUs, you can control the freezer, block I/O sometimes works if the I/O layer supports it. Hard disks are not supporting really well the block I/O limits because hard disks do reorganization of write and read operations, and it is completely not related to any process, what definitely hits the magnetic layer of the hard disk. And here you have a lot of fine-grained subfolders if you go deeper into it. C groups, by the way, has been created by Google exactly for this reason. They wanted this isolation level in Linux. And that the block I/O does not work was from Michael Rubin, who said, as a kernel developer, he has spent 2 years of his life trying to implement block I/O, and it never worked. So another thing, you can look it up. Oh, I don't know if you can read it. Man capabilities. These are the capabilities you can put into a container. Capabilities are a lot of. So the most excessive is cap sysadmin. Then the container has all the sysadmin rights and can definitely a privileged container. It's like privilege is a new root, so you give everything, every right to that container. This is not necessary. If you want to open a network device, it needs something like cap netadmin. What else? You can have cap shown, then it cannot show the ownership of files inside a container. And Docker gives a part of it, and any container runtime gives a part of it to the container, and the others are restricted. For example, change root is not necessary in a container again, but it might be a good idea for some reason. So you have to have it in mind. The detailed explanation is in man capabilities, so read it on your own. It's very long and good maintained man page. So, and then you can see what's going on with the capabilities in a container. I skip the second part and now come directly to Kubernetes. So we have seen several talks about Kubernetes here. And the word is from Governor in Cybernetics, the same root. And it is intended to manage and run containers. It's not intended as another container runtime, but it needs a container runtime. So it's an orchestration layer on distributed container runtimes. It has been derived from Google internal Spark system. There are a lot of stories around this. I skip the story because I don't expect to have so much time. But what the reason is why they do it, they want to have it in multiple cloud and bare metal environments. It's 100% open source. It's written in Go. And what they don't write here, it has the strictest governance of an open source project I've ever seen. So they make a release every 3 months, which means the new stable major version comes out every 3 months. And this means for you, it's not a good idea to tinker around with, I have this Kubernetes version and I run something in production, and I will change the version in 1 year from now. Then you have missed four versions, and catching up with four major versions is in every open source project an absolute challenge. So probably you will install the cluster completely from scratch. And therefore, if you consider running Kubernetes, you should deal with that problem, how to update my cluster in 3 months. It's not the place for tinkering. It's simply you have to think about how big is my team. You can build your own Kubernetes distribution because it's 100% open source. But then you need a team for maintenance. And this means 3 to 5 people. We are doing this for this big customer, but it's a lot of work. Otherwise, go with another with a distribution like CoreOS. Use it out of the box or with OpenShift, which is something different, sometimes much ahead of the other versions or whatever you find. SUSE seems to have a product now, but don't tinker around with a project with a 3 month release cycle and governance. Yeah, the architecture of Kubernetes is remarkable. So you have one layer, which is a master server, and the nodes are the worker nodes. And on the client side, you have a command line interface, REST API, user interfaces as a GUI. So this all works out of the box. There are a lot of discussions at the moment, how much master nodes do I need? And yeah, some people say, OK, I need only one, because the etcd does not really need this replication feature, because I have a completely reliable file system. And then you have to care about that the file system is fast enough and good enough. OK, that's one option. Other people say I have local disks, so I need this raft protocol and need an odd number. Good number is between 3 and 9 of etcd daemons. And this is the only place where you have state. Everything else can fail and can be restarted immediately. The API server, which talks to the schedulers and the controllers, is completely stateless. The only state is in the etcd. So you have to protect them, the etcd cluster, by any means. Anything else is less important. You can restart the API server, then you simply cannot change the state of the cluster. But if you lose the state of the etcd, then something strange happens. OK, this is what you really care about. It. You have an API you talk to, and there somewhere is a cluster. And this simply works. This is a promise. And if you have done it right or use one of the cloud providers' versions, then you have a good chance that it's actually really as easy as it is. But if you have to maintain it on your own, beware, it's a lot of effort. OK, this is a little bit small, so we are going into details now. Here is the master server again. here is the etcd, and here master server is talking to the nodes. On the nodes are these kubelet processes running. And normally, Kubernetes tried to be more or less self-contained, which is not completely done yet. But they run most of the services themselves in containers. So the master server runs in a container somewhere. Not on the same nodes as where the workload is, but you can do it. You can run a master server also on in this workload. Then you have not only an interesting bootstrapping problem, but you also have a stability problem, because then you have to care that another master server allows you to start it. This is an ongoing discussion, I think. A self-contained Kubernetes where actually you don't have the distinction between master and nodes is two years in the future, so we will see it. And if you use COPS in the Amazon cloud, then you already see the master server is a cluster inside the Kubernetes cluster, which has a label that it is a master server. And then you will not drop your production workload on the master servers, but the master servers are part of the cluster themselves. Okay, who never has seen a pod? It's as simply as that. You have normally a YAML file. YAML is a preferred format, but you also can do JSON if you like these curly brackets. You have an API version. It's all, everything is versioned. So it's a good thing. It tells you, okay, this is a description for a pod. You have some metadata, name, label, environment shall be test, the name shall be Nginx. Then you have the spec, and the spec tells, in the easiest case, I want a container. Actually, a pod is a bunch of containers which share some namespaces. I will talk about this in a few seconds. And therefore, it's a list, and it has a name, and it's an image. And if there is nothing else told about the image, then it's from Docker Hub. So this pod pulls something from Docker Hub. This is fine, this is easy, and this can have some security impact. So you should be aware that this is pulling something from outside your company, but at the moment we go for the easy part. And the pod is a core concept of Kubernetes. Definitely it's one of the microservice parts. It's a bunch of containers, they have the same life cycle. This is important. If one container dies in a pod, all the other containers also have to die. They share the same network namespace, so they have exactly the same IP address, so you have a pod restriction, you only can use every pod once, and they have the same local host. They can share data, and they should have one common task. There can be additional helper pods, helper containers like init tasks. For example, if you run a distributed database, they could simply start the replication before the actual database server starts and fetch the data from somewhere. This is possible, but this is, makes it a little bit complicated, and let's start with the simple things first. More important is you have live and readiness checks. Something can be alive, like a database which is loading the entire entire real estate of Germany into the database. It takes 20 minutes, but it is not available because the load is not in memory. And if it's ready to serve, then it can be used from a service. We will see what a service is a little bit later. So with all this, you can create something which has a useful life cycle, and you can use it for as part of like a Lego brick in an ensemble of microservices. Here we have a little bit more details. So this is a deployment. At the moment we have Kubernetes 1.10, and this is stable since 1.9. This is funny because I'm using it for more than 1 year now, and except the version number, it never had a problem. So in every training I gave, I had to change the version number because the deployment does not really show up. But this is stable now, and then it should work forever. What happens here is we have not only a pod. The definition for the pod is part of the entire definition, so it's here. We also have something which is called replica set, which guarantees a number of containers being alive in parallel. So here we have three replicas in a replica set, and they all... So this means three pods of the same kind are spawned normally in a Kubernetes cluster on different machines, but they, if you run it on a minikube locally on your laptop, then you see it obviously in one Kubernetes node. And yeah, so we have a three-fold hierarchy, and we can use it, and we will see how it works together. There are other things which look like pods, for example, jobs. These are simply pods which terminate. We have daemon sets. A daemon set is what a Unix daemon does. You have normally one per node, and this means you can do service things in a daemon set running on each node. For example, checking the hard disk, cleaning up things, or whatever is necessary. One interesting part also are stateful sets. Normally, pods like this are ephemeral. So if they go away, they can be created everywhere. This is good for your web services, not good for your database. And therefore, we have stateful sets, which make sense if you can create a distributed database this way. And the difference is they get exactly predictable names, so they are simply numbered. They can have volumes, and you can this way create database clusters. So in the Kubernetes directory, there is something like Helm. We had this morning an example how Helm looks, and there you have curated charts for this. And curated means they are guaranteed to work in every future version, so somebody really cares about it. And there you find a lot of databases. You find a Kafka, you find a MongoDB, you find Percona. Postgres is not ready yet, but close. So you can use databases inside Kubernetes, but you should be aware you have to care about it. And one warning, if you haven't understood your database outside Kubernetes, your cluster, Kubernetes will not do the job for you. You have to understand your database before you put it into Kubernetes. Otherwise, the full automation is not really working. And the easiest thing is MongoDB, but if you see the Helm charts for MongoDB, they have some complexity. So here is what happens to a deployment. If I create a deployment, the first thing what Kubernetes does is create a replica set. The next thing is replica set creates the exact number of pods it is instructed to do. So in our example, three pods. So we have a very old version of Nginx now, and probably we want to do an update. And if we tell Kubernetes, okay, please use a newer image of Nginx, then it will do a rolling update by creating another replica set. And then step by step, removing an old one after a new one has been created. And you get a rolling update without a service interruption. The important thing is both replica sets exist in parallel, and you don't get a service interruption this way. And this means, for example, there are some constraints, no sticky connections, something like this. So if you do it with J2EE server, which needs sticky connections, then you have a problem here. So be aware that there are some implicit conditions which are not told normally. all the ideas behind the pods are in this paper. It's 6-page design patterns for container-based distributed systems from Brandon Burns and David Oppenheimer. At that time, both at Google, now Brandon Burns works for Microsoft. And you don't have an excuse not to read this paper because it's only 6 pages. So before you try something, try in a train or on an airport, read this paper and try to understand why they are doing this. And actually, the central idea about the pod is a pod is a bunch of applications working together in a constrained environment. Here, the most prominent example, which is called a sidecar, uses a common file system. A web server is writing something to the file system, and the log-saving sidecar container, normally Fluentd, is putting it somewhere and using it to send it to a log system. And you can have more than one sidecar if you want to change your log system or you want to have use Splunk and Hadoop and whatever. You can have multiple things and you can use them to make soft migrations here. Another typical thing is sharding of a proxy ambassador, and it directs things, for example, into different databases. Or you have different security levels here. And this picture is from Roland Huss from Red Hat and shows all the relations around pods. Everything is organized around these pods. So you have the stateful pods, stateful sets, which are pods, jobs, cron jobs, replication controller, here the replica set and deployment, the daemon set is all a pod. You have services which are using the pod. You not only can use a fixed number of replicas, you can say, okay, dependent on the load or any trigger from the outside, I can scale horizontally. I can add additional pods to my service. You have something like a pod disruption budget, which tells Kubernetes how expensive it is to recreate the pod on a different machine if it's running out of resources. You have an ingress, which is more or less full. If you use the right implementation, a full-featured F5 a software, so you save a lot of money. If you have spent a lot of money in F5s, so you can use all these things with instead of creating F5i rules, you can use ingress rules here. It's much less expensive. And obviously your container with your code, and it can run infrastructure things outside. Volumes, you have persistent volume claims. You can say, I don't care about the volumes. Give me 100 gigabytes somewhere. And then you have a storage class which gives you exactly that thing. Other things which are interesting, because we are all doing DevOps mostly wrong, because we don't do it, you can use configurations and put them as volumes into your container. And here you also can have secrets in your container, so your database passwords can be in a different repository, and you can push them into a container from a secret production repository only. Who's changing? As a BSI recommends every week the database passwords. I never had somebody who did. You are insecure, by the way. You are violating best practices from Bundesamt für Sicherheit in der Informationstechnik. But everybody does it. Nobody. I've never had somebody really says, "Oh, I have changed it every week." No, it's not the case. Okay, here again, these things, so everything is around these pods. And let's skip forward. And now, more interesting stuff comes if we go into the network part. So network means we have to connect all the pods with each other and with the outside world. And there are several network models. The easiest one is Flannel. I can explain Flannel. All the other things are much more complicated, but also much faster and more scalable. What they do in Flannel is they slice an entire 16 network, here it's 10, 1, 16, into 24 networks. Every machine in Core S gets its own slice of the network, and then they run the Docker daemon inside here, so it's always Docker. And the Flannel daemon only has a task to switch the same address from a 24 network to a 16/16 network, talk to the Flannel daemon, and then it goes to the outside network interface and finds the other machine and the other port on that machine. And the configuration is completely stored in the etcd. So you have a network definition completely in a configuration. Here for Flannel, they use IP over IP, so there is a tunnel without encryption. This works, there has some latency impact, but the performance is quite close to 100%. Restrictions are obvious. In this model, you only can have 256 machines, and you only can have 254 ports on every machine, which sounds a lot, but the next generation or the current generation of our customers' machine have 1 terabyte of RAM. In the next generation of virtual machines, you can have next year in the clouds are 4 terabyte. And if you have here, so microservice applications, you will probably have more than 256 ports on every machine. So this is a real limit. And one more limit is there is no such thing like isolation. So you cannot isolate services with Flannel easily and say, okay, I split the cluster into two parts, two teams which are not allowed to see each other. This is not possible with this model. But yeah, we'll come to this later. What are the typical applications, the programming languages and the runtimes? We see all the typical things. Typical is Java, Ruby, Python, Go. Go is very popular here, but you also can use .NET inside a container. You can have typical databases, so everything which is there, SQL and NoSQL databases, MySQL works very well, Postgres works well, MongoDB works well, and all the other stuff also. But be aware that you have to care about the persistence here. You can use local and session storage, normally it's cached, it's not really necessary to persist it. And we've seen in the other room the talk from Paul from Rewe, who did a full Kafka inside. He is using Kafka. If you run Kafka or RabbitMQ, please be aware that all the messaging systems have some storage somewhere, so they are not stateless. Kafka is not stateless. RabbitMQ is not stateless. Whatever you use, if it's message system, it is not stateless because it has to be highly available. It has to replicate state into several disks, and it has to cache things. If some service goes down and another comes up later, it has to cache things really for a certain time. If we want to connect to the outside world, we have the simplest way of doing a service. The service in Kubernetes is related to the ports by this app selector. It's a label. This says, okay, this service goes for every Nginx, for every pod which has the app Nginx label. And then it pulls out the information on port 80, puts it on target port 80, and then here you have this mystical thing. You can simply say, okay, use a load balancer. And if you do it on a mini kube, we will see nothing will happen. It will wait forever. But if you do it in one of the clouds, it connects to the outside world of the cloud. So it is in Amazon or in the Google Cloud, it simply creates a public IP for you and creates and opens this service on the outside world, and it is simply exposing your pods to the outside world like a real web server, which is a good thing because it never was so easy. But if you have to implement it on your own hardware, there is nobody doing this for this. This is a service of the cloud providers. Therefore, you pay a lot of money for them. You have to implement it on your own, which is possible. There are connectors, typical implementations. Use a F5 or something like this. You can use an HA proxy. So it's possible to implement it on your own, but you have to do it. This means this is a slot for the outside world to put the IP address of your service into this object. And if you look typically into a microservice application, you are not alone. So this is the blue picture with all the Google logos. I normally have the Amazon picture with all the orange logos. So if you like Amazon more than Google, then you think this is all orange. And the limits of your application are the network on the one side and the storage thing on the other side. Anything between is a good idea for a Kubernetes microservice, so you can have a web portal, you can even have a front-end cache, which is in memory, and then here you have your business logic, whatever this does, and you can scale it independently, and everything works fine. But you simply should be sure that you have some structure inside it. I talked to some people here in Berlin from one of these, we have a big company and we want to be agile and disruptive and create a lot of hubs, and then the people in these hubs say, okay, wonderful, we have microservice. We don't have the need to use these layers anymore. We can connect everything with everything else. So this means microservice spaghetti is on the way, so they will mess it up exactly the same way they mess everything. If they don't restrict the dependencies somehow, the higher layers should only use the lower layers, then this will be a messy microservice in the future. We will clean it up in 5 years for a lot of money, if they survive so long. So, okay, first thing, what is the most strange thing, or what most people don't get, is there is a mindset change. So not only in the way we run applications, but also in the things we do. We have to change from system engineering somehow to DevOps, from hardware-centric to application management, from virtual machines to managed services and pods. And if you want to see the full picture, go to 12factor.net. I call it. And read the instructions here. This is more or less the methodology you should do if you want to be microservice compliant. These are 12 commandments, more or less. You don't have to fulfill everything. But for example, it starts with a very simple thing. Have one code base in revision control. We have customers who don't have revision control. It's a lot of fun. Isolate the dependencies and so on. These 12 things are OK. One remarkable thing is logs are not log files. There's a very ancient idea that everything on Unix is a file, which is wrong. And nowadays, logs are not in log files anymore. So this is what people are mostly complaining if they use systemd. Logs are event streams, not log files, event streams. And they go somewhere and are collected in big systems which do the work of showing up the logs somewhere in a GUI or something like this, or doing it in a database. So this is thing, read it carefully. Normally, if we have a workshop with people, they say, oh, everything is nice, we are 12-factor compliant. And the typical outcome is, yay, they have between 4 and 8 violations of this. It's not completely forbidden to have a violation here. This is not the law. But you have to pay a price for anything you violate here. No? So we create, normally you go from operating system instances to microservices and pods. VM clusters are now pods running on Kubernetes. This is a thing, normally cattle and pets are separated. So first thing you have to do is separate the stateless containers and the databases. If possible, use managed services. There is no need to put every database into Kubernetes. If you can run a database outside Kubernetes and it works fine, this is the last thing you should do. In the cloud, you can use a SQL service of your cloud vendor. There should not be a vendor lock-in if you're using MySQL in your cloud. Configuration management, here I clash with Martin Alfke mostly. There is no need for configuration management because one of the commandments is you should separate build time and runtime. If something runs in production, it should not be changed anymore. The only change you do is you kill the pod, replace it by a new one. Business value, it comes out, is what you can tell to your management. You have a faster time to market, and for you and yourself, what makes it more interesting is you can test more and faster. You can have more teams, it scales better, and at the end you get better quality if you do everything right. So, okay, I skip this. Lifecycle management is a problem. You should not run your containers forever. They should be replaced because they can have vulnerabilities. Runtimes, clean up of nodes, yes. One of our case studies is Immer. This is a Berlin-based company, a telecom subsidiary. They do communication in the cloud in a Kubernetes cluster. Special challenge is they have to be G10 compliance, Grundgesetz Artikel 10. They are not allowed to do something which can be wiretapped by somebody else. So every connection must be encrypted, and it must be encrypted with a hardware security module, which is not under the control of the cloud provider, but under their control. This is possible. They are using Vault, HashiCorp Vault for management, and this works fine. They do the usual thing, Java, Python, Ruby was a little bit hard, and so on. And yeah. And indeed, they turned into a real microservice application. Other customers we had are doing strange things like terabyte machine, 80 cores, 80 gigabyte containers. And this is a picture how to run a Windows in Kubernetes. So Windows in a container in a VM, they use no VNC and they have a sidecar which authenticates against the Active Directory. This is possible. It's easier as running things directly. Another thing is machine learning in Kubernetes. So these good old Fortran libraries you see if you do a pip install are running very well here. You can have notebooks. You have a lot of challenges going to the GPUs. You build containers. The good thing is you can put most of the part into config maps. So you can run code from config maps. And then you have a very fast turnaround cycle if you want to change the model. This is possible. I leave it in the slides. price comparison. They are using a different network model. Kubernetes has a container network interface, which is triggered on every port changing its thing. You can connect it to IP tables, IP routes, border gateway protocol, and the physical fabric. There is no overlay network anymore. It's as fast as the real network. But definitely, it's a challenge to set it up. We contributed the Ansible playbooks to set up an OpenShift with this. OK, if you want more, we can give you credits for the Google Cloud. These are our partners. So we are using Google very heavily. We are Red Hat OpenShift partners. And if you have ideas what we can do for you, just contact me. And this was basically it. Thank you very much.